Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Acha, please be seated. Tilawat Siddiq Atiba Sahib.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يريدون ليطفئوا نور الله بأفواههم والله متم نوره ولو كره الكافرون هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Translation, Abdul Samad Yusuf.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullahi.
The earlier recited verses are in Surah As-Saff, chapter 61, verse 9 and 10, and its translation goes thus. I seek refuge in Allah from Shaitan, the accursed. In the name of Allah, the gracious, the merciful. They desire to extinguish the light of Allah with the breath of their mouths. But Allah will perfect his light, even if the disbelievers hate it. He it is who has sent his messenger with the guidance and the religion of truth, that he may cause it to prevail over all religions, even if those who associate partners with God hate it. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Irfan Hussain Awo Sahib Qasida.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Go on, Islam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad wa barik wa sallim innaka hamidun majid. Ya Rabbi, salli ala nabiyyika da'iman fi hadhihi dunya wa ba'thin thani. Ya ayna faydillahi wal irfani. Ya ayna faydillahi wal irfani. يسعي إليك الخلق كالظمآني يسعي إليك الخلق كالظمآني يا بحر فضل المنعم المناني تهوي إليك الزمار بالكيزاني يا شمس ملك الحسن والإحسان يا شمس ملك الحسن والإحسان نورت وجه البر والعمران نورت وجه البر والعمران قوم رأوك وأمة قد أخبرت من ذلك البدر الذي أصباني يبكون من ذكر الجمال صبابة يبكون من ذكر الجمال صبابة وتلعما من لوعات الهجران وتلعما من لوعات الهجران يا ربي صلي على نبيك دائما في هذه dunya wa ba'thin thani. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam, jazakallah. Very well done. MashaAllah. Translation, Belu Abdul Basit.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum.
This is the translation of the qasida that it was recited. O you who are the fountain of Allah's munificence and a perfect understanding of Allah, people rush towards you thirstily. O you who are the ocean of Allah's grace, who is the bestowers of favor, exceedingly beneficent, all of thirsty people, all towards you, holding their bones in hand. O you who are the son of the spiritual kingdom of beauty and grace, you have spiritually inhumaned the inhabitants of the desert as well as the cities. A group of people was fortunate that they saw you, while others simply had the enchanting, beautiful full moon which has cast spell over me. Inspired by your love, O Holy Prophet, people tearfully recall your beauty and their aching hearts are on fire due to being distant from you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam. Acha, hadith, Khalil Rahman.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. An Anas radiyallahu anhu qala qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam unsur akhaka zaliman aw madhluman. قالوا يا رسول الله هذا ننصره مظلوما فكيف ننصره ظالما قال تأخذ فوق يديه. Translation. Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Prophet of Allah, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, said, help your brother, be he the oppressor or the oppressed. The companions said, O Holy Prophet of Allah, we understand that we should help him when he is the aggrieved party, but how should we help him when he is the wrongdoer? The Prophet of Allah answered, hold his hand. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Mulhuzat Salih Abdul Muiz.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
This is the saying of the promised Messiah, which said, distinction among castes. The various castes are no cost of honor. God Almighty has only made this caste a means of recognition. In these days, even after four generations, it becomes difficult to confirm a person's lineage. It does not behove a righteous person to fall into disputes over castes. Allah, the exalted, has decreed that castes are no means of preference in his estimation. True honor and greatness comes from righteousness alone. This is found in Mafuza, volume 1, page 36. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum. Modin Atfal sahab, brief report.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, beloved Huzoor.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
The current tajneed of members of Ahmadiyya is estimated to be 6,523. 750 of them pays wasiya. We have 514 members of Atfal. We were inactive. We are doing tabligh on them to become more active, to participate in the Darus al-Islam classes all over the country. We have 16 states, we have 57 dil'at, and we have 275 maqam. On the syllabus of Atfal, sequel to the letter we received from His Holiness on the 11th October 2020, stating the need to adopt the work for now syllabus going forward. A new syllabus has been adopted for members of Atfal Ahmadiyya, which is the work for now syllabus, and it is already in use. So a new syllabus has been adopted by for the members of Ahmadiyya, for the Atfal members of Ahmadiyya, and it is now in use, which is the work for now syllabus. Number three is about the Sa'iq. We noticed during the previous Mulaqat of members of Qudam al-Hamadiyya with His Holiness, we asked all the states and the national Sa'iq Atfal. We used to have Sa'iqin to the national level. They came for the Mulaqat, the first one we had with you last year. So we noticed during the presentation that the Sa'iqin Atfal wasn't appropriate to be at the national level and state level. So we have stepped down the Sa'iqin to just the Muqami level. And so we have only Sa'iqin Atfal at the Muqami level, at the grassroots. We don't have at the national and the state again. Assalamu alaikum, Lakatu, sir.
Wa alaikum salam. Now, what is next?
Question, sir, from members of Atfal.
Who is going to ask question?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, beloved Huzoor.
Wa alaikum salam.
My questions are, whenever someone is being bullied in school and threatened not to report to his parents, else he would be beaten more, then what should he do?
You should not be afraid of anybody, right? You tell this to your parents and to the teacher as well, right? And
yes.
You can also tell them that the person has threatened me that if I reported this matter to anybody, he will bully me more. Eh? And even he will beat me. So, no need. Ahmadi should not be afraid of anybody. So, if you want to reform the atmosphere of your school, then you have to be courageous. Eh?
Okay, sir.
Right?
Jazakallah khair.
Our next.
Second question.
I'm
having difficulties in handling my education and Quran memorization at the same time. I do not wish to leave one for the other. What do I do?
Are you memorizing Quran and Sharif? Are you in Hifz class? Are
yes,
you in Hifz class or you are memorizing on your own?
Hafiz class.
Hifz class. Hafiz class. Huh?
Yes, sir.
Achha.
Yes, sir.
You see, so how many days do you spend in the Hafiz class in a week?
I spend weekends.
Weekends.
And
so,
sometimes the and holidays.
So on the weekends, you give your full time to your Hafiz class, and on the weekdays, you give time to your school work. Even in the school, you don't have much homework. So whenever you get time, during the weekdays even, you should try to memorize the part of the Holy Quran which you,
yes,
have,
sir,
you have been taught during the weekend, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, assalamu alaikum.
Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum, beloved Huzoor.
Wa alaikum salam.
There are some allegations from the non-Ahmadis about the promised Messiah, or one of which is the fact that he died in the toilet. How can we respond to this allegation?
You see, they are just making some story. Eh? They themselves have fabricated this story. Prophet Messiah, when he fell sick, he had some stomach problem, but when he died, it was because of his weakness. He was having other ailments as well, and sickness. He died on the bed. Even those people, Hazrat Khilafat Masih the second was sitting beside his bed. Hazrat Khilafat Awwal was there. His wife was there. They were all there before he died, and he was reciting, "Oh Allah, Oh Allah." And even he was praying to Allah Ta'ala that Allah Ta'ala shower his blessing on him. And he was just on the bed. So whatever they are saying, this is all concocted. They're all fabricated. So he died on the bed as the normal man dies. And there were so many witnesses there. Right? Even it was endorsed by the doctor as well, that his death was not a cause of cholera, which, right?
Yes, sir.
Right.
Jazakumullah khair.
Assalamu alaikum, dear Huzoor.
Wa alaikum salam.
My question is, as a science student, hoping to read medicine and at the same time wanting to become a murabbi, I need your advice, sir.
You see, you should try to read medicine. You study medicine, right? You should try to study medicine and become a doctor. And at the same time, alongside your education, you can read the Holy Quran and know the meaning and commentary of the Holy Quran. That you can read it from the available literature of the Jamaat Ahmadiyya, right? And at the same time, you read the books of the Prophet Messiah al-Islam and Ahmadi literature. Then you will have enough knowledge to preach the other people about Ahmadiyyat and Islam, right? But when you are studying medicine, then you will be more useful for the public, for the people of your country, right? So alongside your studies in medicine, you can study some Ahmadi literature, and that will be enough for you to become a good preacher. No need to be a Maulvi. You be a doctor, try to be a doctor and a good preacher. There are quite a number of people in the world who are in the other professions and at the same time are very good preachers. Okay?
Okay.
Right.
Jazakumullah khair.
Assalamu alaikum, beloved Huzoor.
Wa alaikum salam.
My question is, what does the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, do for a living before he got married?
You see, when there was a traditional type of education given to the people, and especially those people who are from the big families and royal families. Prophet Musa al-Islam's family was a royal family in that area, right? And when he completed his basic education, his father actually appointed three teachers for him who gave him education. And when he completed that traditional education, then his father arranged for his job in the government department, in the court, and he lived there in Sialkot. Sialkot is a town, is a city in Pakistan nowadays, and that the Pakistan and India used to be one country, right? But he served there in the court as a clerk or something like that, as a helper of the the court. And this was his source of income. But even then, at that time, when he was doing some job there in Sialkot, he would always debate with the Christian priests. And there are quite a number of Christian priests with whom he talked and had debates. So from the very early, youth, he used to preach the people and would debate with Christians. So he was a great champion of Islam at that time even, right? And he used to earn money from that job. And when he claimed that his father was a very well-off and affluent person and a landlord of that area. So when his father died, he inherited some property from him. And later on, from his brothers as well. And when Allah Ta'ala appointed him as the promised Messiah, at that time he was having quite a big property, and he was earning a lot. And whatever he would earn, he used to spend it on the people, on those people who used to come to visit him for their hospitality, right? So he had two wives. First wife, when he got married when he was quite young, during his father's time, and he had two sons from that first wife. And later on, in 1886, I think, he got married. He married a second wife, and he had some children from her, and five of them lived a long life. And at that time, his source of income was his property, which he inherited from his parents and brothers, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right.
Zakulaka.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum, beloved Huzoor.
No, alaykum assalam.
My question is, please, when will you visit us in Nigeria, sir?
When will you visit us in Nigeria? Allah knows better.
Yes.
Acha. Whenever Allah wishes, I will visit, inshallah. Nowadays, we are passing through a very difficult time of COVID. So travel is very difficult during these days. So whenever the conditions become normal, then we shall see when to visit Nigeria, inshallah. Okay?
Jazakumullah. Yeah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam.
My beloved Huzoor, how can I become righteous?
How can you become righteous? You obey the commandments of Allah. What Allah Ta'ala has said, you try to follow it. And there are so many commandments given to us in the Holy Quran. And there are some basic things. Allah Ta'ala says, if you do it, you will become righteous. That you, when you pray five daily prayers, and if possible in congregation, and pray it very fervently, without deviating your concentration from here to here and there, anywhere else. Concentrate solely on whatever you are saying. Then read the Holy Quran daily, and also try to know what are the commandments given in that portion which you have read during that day, during that time, in a, right? Or in that day, right? And try to behave well, morally good, right? Try to tell good things to other people. Concentrate on your studies, because study is also something which is an obligation, your obligation. And a righteous person should always try to fulfill his obligations, right? So that after having completed your studies, you can be a good asset for the Jamaat and the nation, right? So all these things make you righteous. When you start doing all these things, then as the time goes on, when you grow up, then all these things will be present in you, then you will behave well, you will worship Allah as prescribed by Allah Ta'ala, and in this way you will do all good deeds and things, then that will make you righteous. Okay? Or
Assalamu alaikum, beloved Huzoor.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My question is, if someone has an elderly person at home and while praying, the elderly person needs urgent attention, what is expected to be done?
Someone has an elderly person at home and while praying, the elderly person needs urgent attention, your help. What is expected to be done? So you can, if you are praying at home and you, and any person, even an elderly person or a child or any person who needs your help and he is in urgent need of your help, then you can break your prayer and help the person first. And then after helping, you can again start your prayers and complete your prayers. So Allah Ta'ala says that sometime obligations or duties towards Allah, towards the human being, are more than your prayers, more important than your prayers, right? So this is how we can serve humanity, okay?
Assalamu alaikum, beloved Huzoor.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My question is, how can I get used to performing tahajjud?
That is your willpower, right? Do you get up early morning for Fajr prayer?
Yes.
Right? So try to get up even half hour before that time you are getting up for Fajr prayer. So when you become used to of that time and offer two nafal or two rakat of tahajjud, then you can give, you see, in this way you can adjust your time and so that you can give more time to tahajjud prayer. But this is all your willpower. If you get up for Fajr prayer, you try to get up 1 hour before that time so that you can offer tahajjud prayer. And that all depends on your willpower, and you pray before going to bed that Allah Ta'ala wake you up for tahajjud prayer. Right?
Yes.
Okay.
Jazakumullah.
Assalamu alaikum, beloved Huzoor.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My question is, how can we, as members of Atfal Ahmadiyya, prevent ourselves from world problems like cultism, hooliganism, and so on. What prayer could be said to prevent this?
How can we, as members of Thalul Ahmadiyya, prevent ourselves from worldly problems like cultism, hooliganism, and so on? And what prayers could be said to prevent this? Right? So the thing is that if you are a good Muslim, you are a good tifl. You are a good member of Atfal Ahmadiyya. Tifl is singular. Atfal is plural. Atfal Ahmadiyya. If a single person boy is tifl, and the whole lot sitting before me is Atfal. Right? So, if you are a good Muslim, you should be good tifl. Or if you are a good tifl, you are a good Muslim. So for that, as I already said, that we should offer our 5 daily prayers. And during that, while you are praying, you pray to Allah Ta'ala, that Allah Ta'ala save you, you from all these worldly things. Right? Allah Ta'ala save you from all these worldly things and make you a good and morally good and spiritually good Muslim. Right? So Allah Ta'ala will accept your prayer and He will save you from these things. And at the same time, there are quite a number, as I have already said, quite a number of commandments in the Holy Quran. Some obligations we have to perform them, and there are some duties, other moral duties we have to do. So if we abide by all these things, follow all these things, then they will also be helpful to save us from these bad things. Okay? And then you should also pray to Allah Ta'ala during the day that A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitani Rajeem and Astaghfirullah Rabbi Min Kulli Zambin Wa Atubu Ilayh. Astaghfar will also save you from all these bad things. Astaghfirullah Rabbi Min Kulli Zambin Wa Atubu Ilayh. So that Allah Ta'ala will save you from all the sins which are possible to be committed by any person or which you have done in the past. Right?
Yes. Jazakumullah khairan.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
My question is, what is the strongest argument we can use to convince our non-Ahmadi friends that Imam Mahdi has come?
You see, there are quite a number of arguments. All those Ahmadis, non-Ahmadis or Muslims believe that Messiah and Mahdi will come. And Quran says, and they are thinking that the same Messiah, the Jesus Christ, will come from the heaven. But Allah Ta'ala in Quran says, nobody can live forever or for a longer period. And you have to, whenever a person lives his life, he has to pass his life here on this earth. Nobody can go to heaven. We believe that the Holy Prophet is the last of the Prophet, and he is the most, the person who was loved by Allah Ta'ala in every respect, more than any other prophet. Yeah? So Allah Ta'ala loved him more than any other prophet. So if it was possible to take any person to the heaven, it would have been the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whom Allah Ta'ala could take to heaven. not that he is Christ. Right? Number one. Number two, the Holy Prophet himself, while explaining the verse of the Holy Quran, وَآخَرِينَ مِنْهُمْ لَمَّا يَهْلَكُوا بِهِمْ, that among the people of the latter days, the person will appear, or the people will be like you. So in that person, when the companion of the Holy Prophet asked, who are those people? Eh? And who is that person who will come, appear in this world in the latter days? So the Holy Prophet, after when the people asked three times, then he put his hand on the shoulder of Hazrat Salman Farsi and said, the people, this is a very well reputed narration, hadith. He said that the person from among Salman Farsi will appear in the latter days. That means he will not be an Arab, the Mahdi and Messiah will appear from among these people. So you can tell them that now, even apart from that, the Holy Prophet said that when the claim of the promised Messiah, the promised Messiah will claim that he is the promised Messiah and Mahdi, there will be a heavenly sign. And that heavenly sign is the eclipse of sun and moon on particular dates and days in the month of Ramadan. And he said that this sign has never happened before. So, according to the prophecy, the lunar and solar eclipse occurred during those days in 1894, when there was a claim of the Promised Messiah already there in the Eastern Hemisphere and the Western Hemisphere. And it is well documented, so in the newspaper, that it happened. So these are the signs. Even in the Holy Quran, it says in the latter days, there will be so many, prophecies which he made will be fulfilled, as the redundance of the old days system of transportation. And there will so many new things will appear for transportation. So these are the things which have happened. And there is no claim of any other promised Messiah. Jesus has not appeared. He has not come down. He has not descended from the heaven. So there is only one man's claim. And the prophecies have also been fulfilled and are being fulfilled by Allah Ta'ala. So these are the things which compel us to believe that the promised Messiah, who claimed himself to be the promised Messiah, has appeared and is the right person. And now the Holy Prophet also said that the Promised Messiah will appear in, and the Mahdi will appear in the 14th century. And now 14th century has passed. Even then there is no claim. So since there is no claimant of this prophecy, and there is only one person who claimed himself to be the person, and Allah Ta'ala is also proving his appearance with all the support, and we are seeing that his community is flourishing day by day. So that shows that he is the right person, and the time has also passed, and no other person will come now. So you can only argue with them, but those who are very rigid people and they don't want to believe in anything, they are very stubborn, then you cannot force them to believe. But there are quite a number of arguments, right? So you can read the literature, Jamaat's literature, and you will find more arguments in that. But you see, there are heavenly signs and worldly signs, earthly signs. And they have all been, quite a number of them have been fulfilled. Right?
Yes.
Okay.
Jazakumullah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Jazakumullah khair.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
My question is, why is it that only Ahmadi men can marry Ahmadi women?
Because just to save your generation, your progeny and your children from going to the other religion. So if an Ahmadi boy and Ahmadi girl marry each other, then you are quite sure, at least 80% sure, that your progeny will grow up as Ahmadi. And if any of them parent is not Ahmadi, then there's a chance, quite a big chance, that your progeny, your children, your offspring will follow those religions other than Islam, with the other one of the parent is holding, right? This is why try to advise that Ahmadi should try to marry Ahmadi. But how old are you?
15 years old, sir.
15?
Yes, sir.
You see, you are only 15 years old and there's still some time you get married. Huh? So when you are 25 years old, then you try to get married and try to find a good, pious Ahmadi lady. Right? So that your children, your offspring, your progeny is brought up in a good atmosphere. Right?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next.
Jazakumullah khair, sir.
Assalamu alaikum, the beloved Huzoor.
Yes, sir.
My question is, if someone committed shirk but built a mosque and died, what is his position before Allah?
You see, someone committed shirk and then later on he repented and he sought Allah's forgiveness and then he died, and to prove that he has repented, he makes a mosque for the people to worship one God, then Allah Ta'ala will forgive him. So that is his good end. Allah Ta'ala sees whatever you have done at the end. Before you die, if you repent and seek Allah's forgiveness, then Allah Ta'ala forgives. Right?
Yes, Jazakumullah khair.
Assalamu alaikum, my beloved Huzoor. My question is, I came across Gog and Magog in the Old Quran, Surah Al-Kahf. I want to ask, who are these people, sir?
You see, these are the people who are trying to destroy the peace of the world. Right? This is why Allah Ta'ala says that you seek Allah's help in the latter days when you see Gog and Magog. Right? So that you are saved from the effect of their bad deeds, bad actions, right? And their brutality. And what we have been seeing today, there are some Western powers, big powers, they are playing the role of Gog and Magog. Even some of the priests, they are playing their role. So, to make people go astray and leave their religion. So, Muslims should always be very much vigilant and careful and pray to Allah Ta'ala that Allah Ta'ala save them from the bad effect and of these people and these powers, right? And if Muslim are following the true teaching of Islam and obey what Allah Ta'ala has said, then they will be saved from the bad effect of Gog and Magog, right? And their actions against Islam, right?
Yes.
Okay. You should also pray in your... These are the big powers. These are the big powers who are trying to make you go astray and leave the religion and become an atheist, right? Or at least leave the true religion and follow them, right? And become a mushrik or do shirk. So you have to try to save yourself from them. Always, this is why the Holy Prophet said that a true Muslim should recite the first 10 verses and the last 10 verses of Surah, so that you are saved from the bad effects of these people. Right?
Assalamu alaikum, my beloved Huzoor.
Wa alaikum salam.
My question is, in Nigeria, there are a lot of youth engaging in cybercrime, which is affecting the young ones. What is your advice for Atfal?
You see, this is why I have been telling all the time that you should not involve yourself in playing so many games which can make you to go astray or deviate from the right path, right? This is why I say that you should not involve in so many games which are illegal even. And they also make you addict to play those games. And see, by this, they try, these agencies which are, or the people who are making, or these type of programs or the games on the internet, they are actually spoiling the life of the people and make the younger children addict to these games. And as the time goes on, when they become fully addict, then they are involved in some other bad things. So the Muslims should try to avoid these things, and because ultimately they will involve you in doing cyber crimes, right? So try to save yourself. You say, first, you are made addicted to the games. Later on, in the next stage, some other charm is given to you to play those games, or some other, you are enrolled in some other things on internet, and then later on, you are enrolled in cyber crimes. So try to avoid these things if you want to save yourself. Okay? Only see, try to see good programs on the internet. And never ever involve yourself in something or some games which can lead to the bad things. Okay? All right. Yes, only one question now. That's all?
That was the last question, beloved Huzoor.
Acha, now that's good. Okay, the time is also over.
Jazakumullah khair, sir, for your time, then, sir.
See you tomorrow, inshallah.
Inshallah. Jazakallahu khairan, ahsan jasa.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.